In 1934, a massive gas explosion killed 266 miners at the Gresford Colliery near Wrexham. Their bodies were never recovered and remain there to this day. Many believe that these men were the victims of greed, yet no one was ever charged with their manslaughter. Many believe that 70 years ago, the truth was buried with them. This case is very different to the others I've looked at in this series, and indeed in the whole of my 30 years in the police service. Here we have death on an horrific scale. At 10 p.m. on the 21st of September, 1934, the Friday night shift began at the Gresford Colliery. Over 250 men made their way underground. The mine operated 7 days a week, and on Friday nights, many men chose to double up, working 2 8-hour shifts the same day in sweltering temperatures just to earn a few extra pounds. Many miners have to work overtime just to get by. It was the time of the Depression. Jobs were scarce and poorly paid. Miners were paid according to the amount of coal produced and had to buy all their own tools. Coal mining was the most dangerous of all industries, with an appalling history of suffering and hardship. In 1934, you were 10 times more likely to be killed working down a mine than in a factory. You had a 1 in 7 chance of serious injury. Coal mining was a major employer in northeast Wales, with 27 collieries operating. Gresford was one of the largest. It was opened in 1911 by the Dennis family, who had raised share capital to fund the mining of deep coal reserves. By 1934, it employed 2,200 men and was the super pit of its day. But like many other pits, it was struggling financially. The pressure was on to increase output and boost profits for the owners. In charge was colliery manager William Bonsall, who had run the mine for 17 years. Many men working that night had swapped shifts so they could go to the big Wrexham versus Tranmere Rovers game on Saturday. Azariah Jones was only working that night because his pal's wife had just had a baby and he'd offered to cover for him, even though his own brother's wedding was the following day. At 2 in the morning, most of the men were taking their mid-shift snack when gas ignited at one of the coal faces. A massive explosion tore through the mine. Those who weren't killed instantly were either burnt alive or poisoned by the fumes. Just 6 men managed to escape the inferno, clambering to safety along tiny tunnels. Later that morning, hundreds of wedded relatives assembled at the pit head, desperate for news of their loved ones. Underground, the rescue teams battled in vain to extinguish the fires, and 3 men suffocated. The following day, the rescue operation was abandoned and the mine shaft sealed. The final death toll reached 266. This was the biggest mining disaster for 20 years, and it immediately gripped the attention of the British public. Most of the national newspapers focused on the human interest stories of suffering and heroism. But the left-wing papers of the time soon began asking questions about how the disaster happened. Something had gone seriously wrong at Gresford, but was this an accident, or was it a disaster waiting to happen? Soon, the nation's sadness turned to public outcry as more details emerge of the appalling conditions the miners suffered. The word Gresford would soon become a byword for the exploitation of the working man. This is the site of the former Gresford Colliery. Today, 70 years on, the landscape has changed beyond all recognition. Gone are the mine buildings and the winding gear to be replaced by a modern housing estate. The only reminder that grim September night is this memorial here to the 266 miners who died. But for the local community, the disaster is still an emotive issue.
It must have wrecked the lives of so many people in this area. Azariah Jones was just 30 years old when he died, leaving a young widow and three daughters. The oldest of the three, Clarice, was just 10 at the time.
The one thing I do remember of Dad, we were ready for bed, and Mum kept looking at us, and he had his bicycle, and he was, you know, seeing to the tyres, and of course he was looking at us. And my mum said, "What are you looking at?" And he said, "Oh, nothing. Good night and God bless." And that's the last I ever saw of Dad.
What do you remember about the news when it first came about the disaster?
The postman came to the door, and of course the gentleman didn't know that Dad was down there. He said, "Isn't it a terrible thing? Mrs. Jones has been a accident at Gresford," and that's the first time she knew.
Did your father ever talk to you or tell you stories about the conditions that he worked in the mine?
I don't remember. Just remember what Mum said, that if he told her that anything happened in the pit, he said, "I don't think anyone will get from there because the smell of gas and the conditions, it was very, very hot."
The bodies of the men who died in the pit that day were never recovered.
No, Dad's still there.
Clarice's mother had to survive on the handouts of a relief fund set up for the miners' families. She and the hundreds of other widows did not receive a single penny in compensation from the company. Here at Bersham Heritage Centre, there's evidence of just how ruthless this company was.
This small, crumpled piece of paper must be one of the saddest documents I've ever read, and really demonstrates so powerfully the cruelty and the callousness of the mine owners. This is the last payslip of Humphrey Jones, who was killed in a disaster on the 22nd of September 1934. And in it, it records his pay for that week as 5¾ days. They actually docked him a quarter of a day's pay because he died at 2 a.m. that morning.
It's hard to comprehend such insensitivity today. To help uncover the truth of Gresford, I need to find out more about a miner's life in the 1930s. I've come to meet Jonathan Gammond of Wrexham Museum.
Well, Jonathan, they must have been hard times in those days for the miners.
They definitely were. It was a tough time to be trying to earn a living around Gresford and Wrexham in the 1930s. A lot of the area relied on heavy industry and the coal mines, the steelworks and the brickworks, and all of them were really in the doldrums at that time. I mean, several local pits had closed, and so miners from those pits were out looking for jobs. And I imagine those that managed to get a job in Gresford Colliery knew that there was always someone else who was looking for that job.
You mentioned that some of the other mines had closed, but Gresford itself wasn't doing too well either, was it?
No, Gresford had had quite a few problems. I mean, for several years, it had been making a loss. And I think there was a big pressure on the management of the mine to increase production, decrease labour costs, and in effect, to cut corners if required, though no one would ever actually say that, in order to try and make the mine profitable.
In everything I've read, there's little mention about the Dennis family, the owners. I mean, who exactly were they?
Well, Dyke Dennis, who's the main owner of Gresford Colliery, he was a son of Henry Dennis, and Henry Dennis was a mining engineer from Cornwall, and obviously a very entrepreneurial man. He was sort of the generation that made the money. Dyke Dennis, I think, represents a generation that's living off the money. They just expect it to be delivered to them by their managers.
So in 1934, both the owners and the workers were feeling the pressure of the economic depression. This must have been a factor in the disaster. Within weeks, an official inquiry was opened here in Wrexham. Representing the miners' union was Sir Stafford Cripps, Labour MP and top barrister. So committed was he to the miners' cause that he waived his fees.
Did you work in 14's district? the top end of 14's face.
The inquiry sought to investigate the cause of the explosion and to determine whether the 1911 Mines Act had been breached. Crucially, the Act allowed owners to delegate responsibility for the mine to the colliery manager, and so the owners could not be held responsible for any breaches committed without their knowledge. Gresford's manager, William Bonsall, therefore became the focus of the inquiry.
Have you read the Act?
Certainly.
In your opinion, do you think that what you failed to do was a breach of the Act or not?
I failed to countersign them.
And you have considered the question...
He would give evidence for 20 hours, trying to avoid Cripps's interrogation by claiming ignorance of the problems underground.
Have you ever studied this question of loss of air before and tried to get an explanation?
Yes, we've been studying it all the time.
What conclusions have you arrived at? Come along, Mr. Bonsall.
I've come to the conclusion, I'm quite positive, that quantity of air couldn't go through those doors.
Now, where could it go?
I could never understand where it was going.
Then you didn't take any steps to prevent it, I take it?
We attended the ventilation appliances. That's all that's possible.
But you didn't take any steps to prevent the leakage?
It's always been a mystery to me where it went.
As you didn't know where it was going, nothing was possible to stop it. Is that right, Mr. Bonsall? And it was still going on up to the day of the explosion, wasn't it? That's right, isn't it?
With the mine owners free from liability and Bonsall claiming ignorance, the inquiry failed to hold anyone responsible for the disaster. The management was reprimanded for not performing its duties properly, but no individual was singled out as criminally negligent. The owners weren't even called to attend. But how could Bonsall, as manager of that mine, not know the conditions were hazardous? Somebody must have known of the danger, and whoever knew must take responsibility for the explosion. In Gresford today, there is still a great deal of anger about the disaster, a feeling that justice was not done at the time, and that what happened there was criminal. This will be an unusual investigation, because not only do I need to look at the responsibility of individuals, but look closely at whether the mine company themselves acted criminally. I'm going back to examine the evidence again, because this looks to me like a case of manslaughter. 70 years after the events, it's difficult to separate the facts from the fiction surrounding this case. But there is one man still alive who can help me. Robert Edwards worked as a fitter at Gresford in 1934. And experienced for himself the conditions underground.
Well, Eddie, how old were you in 1934?
In 1934, I was just 21, wasn't I?
21 years of age.
I was 21 then. And it was a disaster.
Yeah. People say that conditions in the mine were very hot.
Like a baker's oven. When you went in, you couldn't go in the pair of holes or like, well, or thick, you had to get cut off and go in, it was that hot.
Was the pit a particularly gassy pit?
Yes, oh, always gassy, everybody. I met one man, he said, look, he said, you've got to keep your mouth shut here because jobs are short. Yeah. And you only work 3 days a week. Then you say, you listen for the hooter and then go to work. The other man, you'd be outside, say, you go to work and the others go home and then you've lost your dough. But I was lucky. I never lost one day. I was working all the while.
All the officials who gave evidence at the inquiry said that, in fact, the mine wasn't particularly gassy. Yeah. I mean, what do you make of that?
About 3 weeks before the disaster, and I was on the coal face by myself, and all of a sudden, up goes my lamp.
Eddie, when you say your lamp went up, you mean that's a signal that tells you there's
gas
there.
Has gone out, yeah. Yeah. I knew I was in danger.
William Bonsall, the mine manager. Did you see much of him down the mine?
He used to come down 10 o'clock every morning and go on the pit bottom and talk to the manager.
So the manager was a regular visitor then?
At 10 o'clock in the morning, down the pit.
Very few miners give evidence at the inquiry, probably because they would be sacked for doing so. But some brave miners did speak up. They all painted a picture of hot, gassy conditions that made working life unbearable.
Did you ever notice gas?
Yes.
Did it ever affect your lamp?
Yes. Put it out on 3 or 4 occasions.
Have you ever actually complained to your fireman about gas?
Yes.
When did you complain to Harold Thomas?
Well, one morning when he went up there to fetch a piece of coal with a pick. Yes, he said. But it isn't as bad as it has been.
What were the symptoms?
Stafford Cripps argued that the hot, gassy conditions were the result of poor ventilation underground.
Was it the general complaint that gas was making people sick?
Yes, there was always complaints about it. I've seen a man drop beside me.
Actually fall down?
Yes, down on his knees, vomiting.
Well, I need to learn more about the build-up of gas underground and how it should be tackled. Perhaps more importantly, I need to know what they should have been doing at Gresford to control the problem.
I'd come to Big Pit in Blaenavon, which once employed over 1,000 men.
There we are, my friend.
It's now a museum, where today's generation can experience the dark tunnels of a coal mine. Taking me down is former miner Paul Green, an expert on underground gas.
Paul, I know that methane is a natural gas underground, but, you know, how dangerous is it?
Oh, very dangerous. It's an explosive gas. Can't smell it, can't see it, can't taste it. We have ways of detecting it with an oil lamp. As we turn the flame down to what we call a little test-in flame, and if we're holding it out, the flame burns on top of it for what percentage is there. If you come to a triangle with the top cut off, you're 1.25% in the general body. So therefore, you would have to turn off electricity in this part of the mine. A little bit higher, complete triangle, it's 2%. You'd withdraw the workforce to a safer part of the mine.
If you discover gas, I mean, how do you get rid of it in this environment?
Right. If it's in the general body, a way of increasing the ventilation to that part of the mine. So good ventilation, brisk ventilation, takes the gases away. Poor ventilation, gases build up and become extremely dangerous.
So Stafford Cripps was right. Ventilation is the key. Poor ventilation can lead to explosive levels of methane gas. The inquiry found that the ventilation system in Gresford was badly designed. Worse still, I've discovered that roof falls had narrowed the roadways to a couple of feet in places, severely restricting the flow of air through the mine. The transcripts of the inquiry are not for the faint-hearted. There are over 3,000 pages bound together in 8 leather volumes here at the Flintshire Record Office. It strikes me that the inquiry got bogged down with the technicalities of mining practice. But what does emerge is a picture of a mine with a cavalier attitude towards safety, a culture of profits before people, all overseen by the manager, William Bonzon. Shockingly, as a result of the inquiry, only petty charges were brought against the company, Bonzon, and 8 other officials. They had to answer 42 charges relating to breaches of mining law. Most were withdrawn. In the end, Bonzon and the mine company were convicted, but only for inadequate record-keeping. They were fined a pathetic £140, with £350 costs. The lives of those 266 men were valued at barely £2 each. No wonder there is still a feeling of anger in the community. It's hard to believe that nobody from Gresford Colliery was actually ever held responsible for the appalling conditions and slapdash safety standards. Bonzon walked away with just a fine for poor record-keeping, but I'm convinced he knew exactly what was going on and should have done something about it. I'm curious to find out more about this failure to keep records. There are no minutes of the court case remaining, but there must be some answers in the transcripts of the original inquiry. Buried in these 8 volumes, I've found 12 pages which, for me, turn this case on its head. They record the testimony of an assistant surveyor, Idris Cuffin. Cuffin had taken ventilation readings that supported Bonzon's claim that there was sufficient ventilation at the time of the explosion. But long after he'd given evidence, Idris Cuffin asked to address the inquiry once more.
Now, that is the evidence you gave. Is there any truth in it at all?
No, sir.
Well, what explanation have you to offer?
Well, after the June measurements, I was told to finish taking them, so I never took any more after those.
Who told you not to take them?
Mr. Bonzon.
Worse was to follow. Not only had Cuffin been instructed by Bonzon not to take the ventilation readings, he was later told to enter false ones. He'd cooked the books.
This is terrible, you know. Do you mean to say that all these measurements that you have down in this book were never taken? All these figures?
I was told I got to make them up.
Who told you?
Mr. Bonsall.
Mr. Bonsall told you to make these up?
Yes, sir.
Could you tell us when it was that Mr. Bonsall made this suggestion to you?
After the disaster.
Did he ask you to come and see him shortly after?
No, I saw him just after.
Well, for me, this changes everything. Bonsall wasn't just negligent. He was acting criminally. I believe that he knew that mine was dangerous. And he didn't want to keep these ventilation records because it would prove the mine was unsafe. After the disaster, he covered his tracks. He falsified the records. This shows guilty mind. If you can prove by an act or omission that causes the death of somebody else, then that's an offence of manslaughter. This is damning evidence. In my view, Bonsall should have been charged with the offence of manslaughter.
But the push for profits couldn't just have come from Bonsall. It must have come from the top, from the money men. So why did Bonsall carry the can? Why weren't the owners called to appear? And disturbingly, why did the miners knowingly work in such dangerous conditions? In the 1970s, Tom Ellis was the MP for Wrexham. But before this, he was the manager of the nearby Bersham Colliery, responsible for the safety of 1,000 men.
To me, one of the interesting things about the inquiry is when you examine the evidence, it falls into two camps. There were a few brave miners who gave evidence, and they said, probably at the peril of losing their job, that the conditions in the mine were poor. And yet all the officials actually gave evidence to the contrary, saying the mine wasn't that gassy, it wasn't, ventilation was okay.
One of the officials, I actually worked under him years later when I started working in 1947, after the nationalisation of the mines, and he told me quite openly that he'd given evidence and he more or less said that he said what he was told to say, which I think is a shocking thing. And I'm not criticising the man, he wasn't strong enough because he couldn't afford to lose his job, and so he did what he was told.
Who told him?
I would imagine the colliery manager. And the colliery manager was doing what he was told to do by the agent. And the agent was actually, quite wrongly, a major shareholder in the company. The whole idea of the agent under the old Coal Mines Act, 1911, was that there was this sort of buffer between the professional running of the mine and the so-called commercial interests. The agent was the man there to act as a sort of umpire, if you like. Now, this particular umpire was clearly very biased in favour of the owners, in favour of commercial interests.
This is another twist I hadn't expected. The agent was John Arthur Harrop, appointed 2 years earlier when the previous agent retired. This was a very unusual appointment, as Harrop had no mining experience, an essential requirement for an agent. He was, however, the third biggest shareholder in the mining company and the company secretary. There was clearly a conflict of interest here. The impartial role of the agent had been given to someone who profited from the mine. Harrop is mentioned in the inquiry, but never gave evidence, as he died the day after the disaster, following a short illness. But had Harrop lived, could he have been the link back to the owners and a way of prosecuting them? As a major shareholder and the mine agent, there's no way he could have claimed ignorance of what was going on. This is a vital piece of evidence in the case against the mine owners. Contrary to the 1911 Coal Mines Act, the owners must have known about the conditions at the mine and were therefore responsible for the men's deaths. Whether they could have been successfully prosecuted is another matter. As for Bonsall, I think he should have been called to book for the willful neglect that led to the deaths of 266 men. Quite how he got off with a fine, beggars belief. I'm curious to see what Solicitor Stuart Hutton makes of it all.
Stuart, I think there was sufficient evidence to charge Bonsall, the mine manager, with the offence of manslaughter. He knew the mine wasn't safe. Following the disaster, he actually falsified the records to show that the mine was adequately ventilated.
I'm inclined to agree. There's no doubt he had a duty of care, and that the breach of that duty of care amounted, it was so serious that it amounted to gross negligence. And he would fit within the frame, clearly, of having been responsible for the deaths, as you've outlined.
Taking my supposition one step further forward, if Bonsall had been arrested and interviewed, I am sure that he would have probably told the authorities about his relationship with Harrop, the mine agent. Harrop, of course, was a shareholder. And I'm sure he would have told them about the fact that there was pressure on him to maximise production and to cut corners. And if I could establish that link, then that pulls Harrop into the dock. And as an owner, it brings the owners against a criminal charge.
It'd have to show that Harrop had some knowledge of the breach of the duty of care, that the ventilation system wasn't working. If that could be established, it would need to know really the extent to which he was made privy or a party to what was going on. And by doing that, you would inject then the possibility of corporate manslaughter.
Sadly, Harrop died a day after the disaster, so it was a line of inquiry that could never be followed.
We'll never know. But clearly, something very wrong, and clearly, morally, the company must have known what was going on.
This is a tragic tale of corporate greed and indifference to the real dangers that faced the men in that mine. What we learn from Gresford is that a greater value was placed on profits than men's lives. In 1934, life really was cheap. Ultimately, it was the responsibility of the owners and the management to ensure the conditions at Gresford were safe to work in. And in that duty, they failed. As for William Bonsall, he walked away with a nominal fine. But he knew if he had done his job properly, the lives of 266 men would not have been lost. I think he must have punished himself for that every day for the rest of his life.
Dick Penderin, martyr of the Merthyr Rising.
Without any political voice, they were powerless. So many of them started to take matters into their own hands.
Crimesolver, same time next week here on BBC One Wales.